Well, welcome back. This is part three of the session on how do we go from genetic discoveries to mechanistic disease insight. And in this last part, I will focus a little bit on the software tool Magma for conducting gene-based and pathway analysis. So in the practice, you will learn how to work with Magma. And that's a tool that was created by Christian De Leeuw a couple of years ago, and it can be downloaded from this website over here. My GeneSet analysis requires you to work with a command line interface, which should now be quite familiar to you. And as an input, you can either provide raw genotypic and phenotypic data, or you can also provide summary statistics from already published GWAS results. But then you would also need some reference data because we need information on the LD structure of between the SNPs that are part of your analysis. And then the other input is gene definitions. So that's which SNPs belong to which genes. And I will come back to that in the next couple of slides, and also definitions of gene sets. But if you download Magma, there's some files that have some default files that that you can use that do this for you, but you're also free to use your own files if you want to. So just as a side, if you want to have access to published summary statistics, we created a database, and on this slide I've just added one example. When you're interested in looking up one particular GWAS, then it gives you the Manhattan plot, it gives you a gene-based plot, it gives you the QQ plot, it also gives you gene sets outcome already, and it gives you some information about this GWAS with the link to the PubMed ID and where to download the data. So, but that's, you can use this database if you want to play around with any software tool that requires you to input summary statistics. Then yeah, you can just download summary statistics from this database, but there's also some other databases that have the same purpose. To make my gene set analysis, there are three main steps. So step one is the annotation, where we map SNPs to genes. And so Magma needs to know which SNPs do I have to analyze as part of which gene. So that's step one. Step two is the gene analysis. So that's where we compute the association of the gene with the phenotype. So here the unit of analysis is the gene. And then step three is the gene set analysis, where the association of gene sets is tested against your phenotype. And then because it's a very general linear regression framework, which can easily be extended, it's very easy to use continuous sets. So instead of having a dichotomous set where genes are either a member of the gene set or they're not a member of the gene set, you can also have a quantitatively defined set of genes where every gene has a value that indicates how likely it is to be part of a gene set, or that indicates the expression level of a gene in a cell type, and then the cell type is the gene set. And it also allows you to do conditional and joint analysis and interaction analysis, as was explained in part two of today's lectures. Now, going back to the three main steps, annotation. If you download Magma, it comes with a general annotation file, and their SNPs are mapped to genes based on their physical location. But you can also change this annotation file. So you can, if you would like to have eQTLs included in it, you can map SNPs that are physically located outside of a gene but have a known eQTL link to the gene, or a chromatin interaction. That's also possible to use. And you can also add a window around the gene. So you can say, well, I would like to have maybe 1 megabyte before and after the gene, and those SNPs should also be analyzed as part of this gene. And one SNP can actually be mapped to multiple genes. Then if you run the analysis, there are 4 models that are available in Magma. If you have the raw genotypic data, then it will conduct a principal component linear regression analysis, and that can only be done when you have access to the raw data. So if you have, if you input summary statistics, which most of you will probably do, then there are 3 different models that you can use to evaluate statistical significance of your genes. and of your gene sets. So the first model is the SNP-wise mean, and that performs a test on the mean SNP association. So that evaluates the evidence for association of all of the SNPs in that are located in gene, and then uses the average association to evaluate whether the gene is actually associated. Or you can do the SNP-wise top model, where the focus of the analysis is whether it's on the stronger SNP association. And you can also combine these two models and get the SNP-wise in the SNP-wise multi-model, where the evidence from both of these previous models is combined into one p-value for your gene. And in deciding which model is the best for you, that depends on what your actual hypothesis is. So what kind of sensitivity would you want? So there's no, we don't think that there's a best model. It really depends on the situation or your research question. That's why we provide multiple models in the Magma tool. Now, being done in the Magma tool, so when you do a gene set analysis, that's basically an analysis of genes. So instead of individuals being your unit of analysis or your data points, the genes are the data points in the analysis. So in this table, we have listed 10 different gene IDs, and each of these genes have been tested for association in the gene-based step in Magma. So they all have some kind of measure for the strength of the association with your phenotype based on your GWAS summary statistics. And then there's also an indication of whether or not they are part of the set of your gene set that you would like to test. So in this case, the genes are the data points, and the gene set is the grouping variable, and the genetic association with the phenotype, that's the outcome that you would like to get. So this is basically a simple t-test of testing whether the average association of the genes that are inside your gene set is different from the average association of the genes that are outside of your gene set. Yeah, so that's basically just a one-sided test of genes, because you have a very strong hypothesis of that association should be stronger. Now, there are two kinds of t-tests. So you could do a self-contained analysis where you ask whether the mean or the average genetic association of genes in a gene set is greater than zero. Yeah, so that's your null hypothesis and your alternative hypothesis. Whereas in competitive analysis, you ask whether the mean genetic association of genes in a gene set is greater than that of the genes outside of the gene set. Yeah, so that's your competitive analysis. And compare this with a randomized control trial or if in any experimental setup. So in a self-contained analysis, we would ask, is the mean improvement of patients in a treatment group greater than zero? Whereas in a competitive analysis, you would have a control group. So you would ask whether the mean improvement of patients in the treatment group is actually greater than that of patients in the control group. Now, everybody would agree that we would want to do a competitive analysis. We would need a control group. Otherwise, we cannot really say that the treatment is causing the patients to improve. So that's also the reason why we think competitive analysis is the way to go in gene set analysis, and that self-contained analysis are not informative for asking the question whether your set of genes that you tested is actually causally associated with your trait of interest. Yeah. Advise never to do a self-contained analysis, but always to use a competitive gene set analysis. Okay, just stressing that same point, and also in part two of these lectures of today, I've indicated this. So if this is not clear, then maybe you should go back to part two of the lecture. So I hope that this message does come across, and I'm looking for all at the Magma practical, which is planned later today. Thank you for listening, and see you later.